So today I will actually try to coin a new term in order to express what I consider to be one of the most revolutionary aspects of the blockchain, which is the ability to create new autonomous entities which are independent and self-sufficient. And in order to illustrate this concept, I will use the example of the Plantoid, which is an experiment that I started over 1 year ago in order to use artistic practice in order to explain exactly this revolutionary aspect of the blockchain. So what is a Plantoid? Well, you have one right here, which I will activate soon. But essentially, a Plantoid is to a plant what an Android is to a human. It is a mechanical, electromechanical structure that replicates the characteristic of a plant. But there is one important distinction between a Plantoid and a plant, and this is in the way in which they reproduce. So most plants actually are not able to reproduce themselves on their own, and they require the help of bees or butterflies in order to help them through the pollination process. Now, Plantoids do not actually require pollination, but they rely on the process of capitalization. And for this, they do actually need the help of human beings in order to help them accumulate the funds necessary to reproduce. So at the most basic level, the Plantoid is made of two fundamental components. One is the body, the mechanical structure, and the other one is the soul or the spirit of the Plantoid, which subsists as a smart contract on the Ethereum blockchain. And those two components interact with one another in order to actually ensure that the Plantoid can reproduce itself. So let's go to the process of reproduction of a Plantoid. The first step is the capitalization process, which is where the Plantoid will actually beg human beings to give it some money in order to be able to reproduce itself. So I will now do a demonstration. I will feed this Plantoid with some Bitcoins. And hopefully, it's going to be thankful for that. It will take a little bit. But the way it works is basically that the Plantoid comes with its own Bitcoin wallet, and it's constantly monitoring the balance of its own account. And at some point, it realized that it has accumulated a sufficient amount of funds in order to reproduce itself. And this is what will trigger the smart contract on the Ethereum blockchain and will lead to the second phase of reproduction, which is the mating phase. And this is where the Plantoid will actually look for human beings who are willing to help it reproduce itself. And the way this works is that the smart contract on the Ethereum blockchain will open a call for submission, inviting people to submit proposals as to how they envision the next version of the Plantoid to look like. And then everyone who actually has funded the Plantoid initially can then express his voice as to which one they think is the proposal that should be selected by sending a microtransaction to the Bitcoin address which uniquely identifies those proposals. And then this vote is weighted by the amount of Bitcoins that everyone has sent to the original Plantoid, and the smart contract is then processing all this information and will identify who the winner is. And this leads to the third phase of reproduction, which is the phase in which the Plantoid will then be able to hire a new person in order to create a copy of itself. And this is done by the Plantoid signing a Bitcoin transaction together in collaboration with the original artist that created it, which also holds a signature on this account, in order to transfer the funds that have been accumulated to a new artist, which will then be in charge of creating the new Plantoid. And then on top of all these, there is the pyramid scheme, which is a necessary incentive for artists to actually create the most beautiful Plantoid as they can. And the thing is that whenever the Plantoid accumulates sufficient amount of funds to reproduce itself, it will send a small portion of these funds back to its parents, to the Plantoid that generated it, and also a small royalties to the artist that actually made the Plantoid. And this means that now every artist has actually a really strong incentive to create a really beautiful Plantoid, but also to maximize the visibility of this Plantoid and to actually encourage the remix and the making of derivative works of the Plantoid. So this obviously clashes a little bit with the traditional conception of copyright law, which is based on the notion of scarcity and exclusivity. But most importantly, it actually shifts the model around, because instead of funding an artist with the expectation that this artist will create new works that we might like, we can now fund directly the art piece itself, which will then be in charge of selecting and then hiring the artist that the printer has decided should reproduce. And so, in some way, this is actually the extreme model of the open source logic, where the art piece actually acquires a life on its own and is able to evolve independently of the will of the original author. And so, in some way, this can be regarded as an evolutionary algorithm, as the plantoid evolves and expands into multiple branches or species, and the popularity of which will depend ultimately on how popular and how beautiful the plantoid according to the environment in which it sits. And so, it should be obvious by now why the plantoid actually qualifies as a blockchain-based life form, because it fulfills those three core characteristic of being autonomous, self-sufficient, and most importantly, it is capable of reproducing itself. But the plantoid is actually just one example of a much more generic concept of decentralized autonomous organization, where in this specific case, the mission of the organization is actually to reproduce itself in the form of a plant. But the plantoid is actually not the only one of its kind. And in fact, recently, about 2 weeks ago, a new decentralized autonomous organization is born. And its name is the DAO, and it is actually quite impressive in that it has managed to raise over $120 million in just 2 weeks of its existence. And the way the DAO works is actually quite similar to the way in which the plantoid works, only that it provides a much more generic framework for decentralized organizations. So people can send funds to the DAO, and then they will receive some tokens in exchange. And those tokens will enable them to participate into the governance of the organization. And then anyone can submit a proposal as to how they envision those funds to be spent, and then all the token holders can then express their voice as to whether they think that this proposal should be funded or not. And so, again, we can see that even though it does not actually have a physical embodiment, the DAO actually also qualifies as a blockchain-based life form in that it is autonomous as a leaderless organization that is actually regulated only through its code. It is also self-sufficient because it is able to collect funds in order to actually ensure the ability to operate over time. And of course, it is also capable of reproducing itself because the model of the DAO can actually be taken and modified and forked in order to actually give life to a whole new variety of decentralized autonomous organizations. And this is actually quite important because if we look at the way in which the DAO has been implemented, even though it is actually quite revolutionary in that it relies on this trustless and decentralized infrastructure that enables it to be autonomous, if we look at the governance model of the DAO, it's actually quite traditional, that it relies on a set of shareholders, or in this case, token holders, which actually can engage into the governance, and then a few number of elected board members, which have this special power of approving or vetoing the funding of a proposal. And so this is important because it actually shows that there is a really important gap, in that we do now have this really powerful decentralized infrastructure, but we still do not really have figured out a decentralized governance structure that we could plug on top of this. And of course, it is always possible to plug a centralized model on top of a decentralized infrastructure, but then to some extent, we actually cannot enjoy the full benefits of decentralization. And then the closest thing that we have to a decentralized governance model is actually the free market. But as we all know, the market can actually quite easily be manipulated by powerful actors, and it might not always lead to the most effective outcome for a democratic society. And so this brings back to this question as to whether the blockchain can actually provide the necessary infrastructure in order to enable a real collaborative economy by eliminating the figure of the middleman or the intermediary and enabling people to cooperate in a much more decentralized manner. But if we look at most of the real-world applications of the blockchain today, we can see that they are actually promoting quite an individualistic approach to collaboration, as they create this trustless infrastructure that enable people to interact with each other even when they do not know each other and without the need of actually trusting each other and engaging into any kind of social relationship. And this is actually quite different from the original conception of the collaborative or the sharing economy. And indeed, the prospect of living in a purely trustless society, which is regulated by code, and where people interact with one another mediated through this trustless technology, is perhaps not the most appealing one. And of course, it doesn't need to be that way. It is always possible to plug on top of this trustless infrastructure a new layer of trust or a trust protocol that will enable people to collaborate and to actually engage into trusted interaction while maintaining the benefits of decentralization. And so this is what actually motivated me to work on Backfeed, which is building a decentralized value distribution and reputation system that can be used as a distributed governance model for decentralized organizations. And the idea with Backfeed is to move away from this notion of distributed autonomous organizations, which are designed around the concepts of automation, optimization, and trustless interaction, and to move instead forward the notion of decentralized collaborative organizations that promote a more cooperative approach and enable people to co-create and to actually engage into social cohesion. And so, to conclude, I guess that I will just say that we do now have those tools with blockchain technologies and smart contracts to actually build a more decentralized society. But it is then up to us now to decide whether we can use those tools in order to implement a completely trustless society or whether we can actually implement a smart social contract to actually enable a true collaborative economy. Thank you. And by the way, if you do have some bitcoins or some ether that you don't know what to do with, I invite you to send them to the Plantoid and she will show some form of appreciation for that. Thank you.